Hi everybody, welcome back. We are moving along in the EBP process, and we are moving along to step four in the seven-step process of evidence-based practice. And in this module, we're going to be covering steps four, five, and six, which is integrating evidence into your decision-making process, measuring outcomes, and disseminating outcomes. So that's what we're going to cover in the next module. So we're going to. Here's our objectives. We're going to be talking about return on investment related to EBP, differentiating different types of outcomes and ways of measuring them, making sure we're looking at measurable outcomes, describe connections between benchmarks and EBP, and how evidence-based practice can really help you in achieving external and internal benchmarks. We're going to discuss the importance of disseminating results of our EBP work, our projects, and the work that we do related to improving outcomes and making sure that we're sharing those results with others. And we're going to list different ways that we have disseminated projects very effectively and share those with you. So we're going to start by looking at our EBP steps. And as you can see, we're in this big red box, integrating. Which is the step that's about, you know, we've come through that middle part where we've formulated our question and we've been out looking at we searched for the evidence and then we critically appraised the evidence and we brought our body of evidence together in through synthesis, and now we have the courage to make a decision. We have made a decision that we need to make a practice change, and now we're going to integrate that evidence with the other main things that are included in the EBP decision, which is clinical expertise and patient preferences and values, because evidence-based decision-making isn't evidence-only decision-making. It includes those other two pieces. So that's what we're going to be talking about next, and then we'll be moving on to outcomes. So here's the steps lined up as we've been looking at them. So we're here in step four, and we are going to be talking about this piece. Now, I want to emphasize here that we're talking about integrating evidence with expertise and preferences and values to make practice decisions. And I want to emphasize that not all practice decisions are clinical practice decisions. There's leadership practice decisions. There are practice decisions related to academic practice. So it's not just decision, you know, EBP is not just for what should we be doing about CAUTI or pressure ulcers or that sort of thing. Evidence-based practice is really when you're making any decisions, whether they're administrative decisions or patient care decisions, evidence should be part of what you're including in those decisions. So I want to emphasize that EBP is for everybody, not just for clinicians at the bedside. So here's a picture that I'm going to share with you about how traditionally problems are solved in clinical settings. I spent 26 plus years of my life in a lot of meetings about how we were going to fix things. And many times and many meetings, we talked for long periods of time about what should we do. We need to make a decision. We had, you know, a quality issue and we need to fix it. We need to fix it quick. And so traditionally, you bring a bunch of people together and you brainstorm and you pick an idea. And then you implement it and then you measure to see whether it worked or not. And a lot of times you apply a lot of quality metrics and quality systems to it to make sure we're doing the new thing as efficiently as possible. But what we haven't spent a lot of time doing is making sure we're making a good decision to begin with in terms of how we fix things. So here's a picture of how we traditionally try to solve problems. We identify the problem, we have a brainstorming session, we pick an idea, we spend the resources on it, we implement it, we measure it, and we say, oh, it's still not fixed. And then we do the exact same process again on the same problem. And then that didn't work. And then we do the exact same process on the problem again. Meanwhile, problems still aren't getting fixed because we're just trying things. And EBP is the way that you can stop just trying things and that you can add one additional step, which is go look at the evidence. And by applying that one extra step, hopefully you can break out of this repetitious cycle of not fixing problems. Because when you look at the evidence, chances are the evidence will drive the decision and the evidence will tell you what's most likely to work. And so instead of this picture, we end up with this picture, which you identify a problem, you go out and review the evidence, you synthesize it, you apply the evidence-based decision to your setting, you put the resources towards the evidence-based solution, you measure your success or your failure, and more likely you're going to resolve the problem because you've picked a good idea to implement. And so this is what the whole point of all this is about, is not doing things the way we've always done it, which is fixing problems quickly, because that's the metric we're all going for. How fast did you react to the problem and fix it, or apply a solution? What we're measured on is quickness of response rather than the best response. So this is the paradigm shift. But this is what we're talking about, is adding this one extra step when we have a problem brought forward and we say, let's look at the literature and see what it says. So how do we then take the process that we've all been learning, go out and look at that literature, bring it back to the problem, and then integrate it into a decision relative to implementing a practice change? And so you integrate the evidence with our clinical expertise, what we know about the organization, what we know about our community, what we know about a particular patient population, what we know as clinicians through our experience, and who is the particular patient that we're working with. And when you put those three things together, now you're making an evidence-based decision. Okay? So what do we want to make sure we're including or thinking about in addition to the evidence? So we spent a lot of time figuring out how to get the evidence. That's what we've been talking about all along. So we have the evidence now. We have a body of evidence. It says we should do something differently. Okay, that's what the evidence says. But what about clinical expertise? And what about patient preferences and values? What do we need to know about those things? And what does that really mean? So expertise, what is it? It's the ability to perform with excellence in a specific area involving intellectual and cognitive effort over a sustained period of time. So expertise comes with doing and knowing over time and becoming good at something because you've been in it for a long time. And it's a complex notion, but it's acquired experientially, expertise. So you can have knowledge, but expertise comes from the knowledge applied. And when we don't have expertise, we oftentimes can have very negative outcomes. So EBP really does value and hold in high esteem clinical expertise, because there's a lot of times where evidence alone is not the best answer. You know, for example, if you're a clinician and you are seeing a three-year-old with an ear infection, and the best evidence says the right thing for a first-line antibiotic for this child would be amoxicillin, and when you go to prescribe that, the mother says to you, oh, she's allergic to that. Little Susie's allergic to that. Even though the best evidence says it should be amoxicillin, your expertise plus the patient's perspective, which is the individual patient, says we're going to trump that evidence and go to the next thing. That's not the best thing, because we know more about the situation. We want to make the best decision based on the evidence and our expertise and the particular patient. That's what this is all about. But you can't trump the evidence unless you know what it is. So that's how these three things come together and work together to make the best decision. And what about patient preferences and values? We could spend a whole semester talking about patient preferences and values and what are they, and are we really sure that we are asking the right questions to understand where a patient is coming from? Do we really know what their values are, and how are we garnering that information? But suffice to say, for the purposes of this, let's just say every patient is different. And unless we spend some time understanding the patient and having some narrative dialogue with the patient and their family and the context in which the care that we think we should be providing to this patient is going to be happening, just evidence-based care plopped down in the middle of every single patient situation is not going to have the same outcome, because we have to understand the context in which the care will be received. So every patient is different. And patients rarely ever just have one problem. They're complex. They come from complex families and social situations and family dynamics and all the things that we know. So it's very important to have a good perspective on who is this particular patient, what is their history, what is their cultural situation, what's their financial situation, what kind of support do they have, where do they live, Do they have a car? Can they get where they need to get? All those kind of things. We have to be considering all those things when we bring to the conversation what the best evidence says would be appropriate in this situation. And then we have to begin to figure out of that, what is the best fit for this patient. The patient's opinion counts. I mean, we could just say to a patient, you need to do this. This is the right thing to do. And they could say, I'm not doing that. So we could have all the best ideas in the world, but if the patient says, I'm not doing that, we have to have plan B. We have to be thoughtful about what plan B is going to be, because what good is the best evidence if the patient is unwilling or unable to integrate it into their real world situation? So some of the skills that are important for understanding patient preferences and values are active listening, really engaging with a patient, really explaining things and making sure that we're testing whether that we've been heard, having the patient repeat what they think they heard from you. So that's very active listening, that we're making sure we're talking and listening and checking in with each other, all right? We have to gather a lot of information, right? We can't just ask these peripheral questions and think we know what we need to know. We have to communicate with each other on our team, our healthcare team, and make sure that what nursing knows is shared with medicine, what medicine knows is shared with nursing, so that we're all coming to the patient situation with shared knowledge about the patient and their preferences and their values. We have to be ethical in how we present things. We have to be forthcoming with information. We have to present information in ways that patients can hear it and understand it. And we have to understand how the patient learns and how the patient processes information. It's our responsibility to frame the information in a way the patient can receive it and hear it and understand it. So these are the skills that we learn back in nursing school, medical school, and those kind of things. But they're very important concepts in terms of how do we get the evidence that we've spent so much time gathering and processing and synthesizing and making sure we know what the right thing and the best thing to do is. Then how do we navigate the patient and the situation in order to have our best shot at having that evidence-based decision and that evidence-based idea really happen so that we do get the outcome that we're looking for. So once we have the evidence, we have to then find the right mechanism to get the evidence-based practice to actually happen. So it's a very, very important step for us to understand.